Hi, everybody. I'm Matt Boudreau. I'm a producer, engineer, mixer, and I'm here today to give you some interesting tips and tricks, tell you a little bit about what I do and how I do it. I'm an instructor here at Pyramind. I teach audio 101 and 110, audio 201 and 210. We teach a lot of music production things in those classes. When I'm not at Pyramind, I'm outside in the field working part-time over at KFOG, where I record and mix over at the KFOG play space, where lots of famous artists come through and record in front of an audience, and then I hand my mix that I do on the fly there over to the program director that gets put on the air that day. So it's a pretty exciting job, pretty edge of your seat kind of mixing. I get to work with people like Florence and the Machine, Thomas Dolby, Death Cab for Cutie, Tori Amos, The Shins, people like that. So that's quite exciting. And then when I'm not doing that, I'm actually freelance engineering in the Bay Area primarily and working with bands like New Diplomat, The Welcome Mat, and a lot of bands you may or may not have heard of in general. So let me take you through what I've got today. I've got this mix that I want to take you through how I keep my mixes organized. That's a big part of how I get stuff done and get it done, not quickly, but efficiently. So let's go over to the screen here and let's check out what I've got. This is, it's the song Stepping Stone. It's a cover version by some friends of mine that got together to play, actually for a Pyramind class. And I think what I want to point out first is how I have the screen set up, or how I have the Pro Tools session set up. You're going to notice there's a lot of color here, and that's definitely for a reason. So left to right, let's just start over here. I'll highlight this. I've got my bass mic and my bass DI. That's color-coded in its color. Obviously, the drums have their own color, percussion, drum buses. All the buses I color code with nothing. That way, when I'm looking at the edit screen, those no color buses and their automation lanes are kind of separating all of the regions, which that combined with those colors makes it really easy for me to make or find my way around, I should say. Then we have, keyboards in this department, vocals and some vocal buses. And the pink things are my reverbs. And I do pink because I think it's like candy. Reverbs, delays. It's like candy, right? That's what I figured. And then I've got a master bus, a master fader. And I'll explain a little bit more about that later. But then I have my mix track where everything ultimately goes. And that's whether I'm mixing in a hybrid format using outboard analog pieces, in the box, out of the box, whatever. I always have a mix track, and on that mix track is where I have my stereo bus processing, and next to that, the mix track feeds what's called the print track. And that's where I can actually print a copy of the mix, and I can playlist all of the different versions of the mix and kind of keep a history so that, I don't know, if anybody were to open the Pro Tools session in years to come, because that's one request I get, like I'll work with an artist, the record will come out, and then, 5 years later, I'll get that phone call. That phone call will say, hello, hey, Matt, do you have that Pro Tools session by any chance from long ago? Because we want to make a change to it and repurpose it for some other reason. And I go into the session, I can pull up the original mix and listen to the mix that was printed there. And that's really helpful because sometimes, obviously we're all upgrading, Pro Tools sessions are changing, plugins are coming and going with those upgrades. So it's great to be able to hear the mix in its purest form right there on the timeline. And then with hearing that mix, we can obviously also see what other plugins we've got that are missing or intact and compare and contrast. So let's also talk about the routing. So we got the color coding out of the way. So all the different instruments are one, you know, are specific color, and that helps visually identify things. Then let's talk about the routing. I've also got everything's going to its own bus in this case. So the bass has a bus, the drums have a bus. A couple things don't, like the percussion just goes straight to the mix track, but and guitars in this case do as well. Drums, keys, vocals. Excuse me. And very important too, I make sure and label everything. So you'll see the basses are going out the bass output, and the bass output feeds the bass bus, which then goes to the mix bus, which then feeds the print track. And all of that's labeled along the way so that there's no audio, you know, input one and two or bus three and four. There's no, like, it's not numbers, it's names, which really makes it easy for me. So this mix today, I've got a few things to show you beyond the organization. And I will start off by saying there's a lot of possibilities for plugins that you can use. And I know not everybody's got the same plugins. So I'm a big McDSP, Universal Audio, and Massey plugin fan, as well as Slate Digital. And today, instead of filling this mix up with a bunch of plugins that you may or may not have, I've purposely used only the plugins that come in Pro Tools. So the EQ and the compressor and the Endeverb, basically anything that you would get in a Pro Tools session without having to buy third-party plugins. So we'll just kind of level the playing field. Also, I'm mixing in the box entirely for this. I'm not using any hybrid approach or summing mixer or anything like that. I'm just sticking to in the box, bare bones, what comes with Pro Tools. That way you can say, hey, I've got that too. I can try those techniques and try what Matt's doing here. So let's listen for a sec to the track. This is not a finished mix, but in progress. But let's hear where it's at. And I want to point out a couple things to you afterwards. But let's get a sense of what the track sounds like. Okay, great. So you get the gist of the song, where it's going. Now, problem that I always run into is when I'm mixing, I always manage to get everything, you know, really sounding pretty big up to a point. And then, you know, as the faders creep up and the mix starts to build, I notice that drums always kind of start to lack a bit. And that bums me out. I'm a drummer, so I'm expecting the drums to be, you know, punchy and powerful. Because I mix mostly, you know, rock, pop-based music, I'd say. So the trick I want to show you here is what's called parallel compression. And I, by no stretch, am the inventor of this. You know, others before me started doing this long ago. I heard about it really primarily from... I heard the mix engineer Michael Brower talk about it. Michael Brower is an East Coast-based mix engineer who he's quite well known for his work with Coldplay, and he does great mixes. So I like taking people's ideas like Michael Brower and cherry-picking them and making them work for my thing. So I may not be doing this exactly like Michael Brower, so you can't fault me for that. I'm doing it the way I would do it and take that idea. So let's look at this first. All right, so we have, let's solo the drum kit right here, minus the percussion at that. And let's just solo it with the one primary bus. Okay, that sounds great to me. And on its own, it would be perfectly fine. And that's my friend Michael Urbano, by the way, playing drums. Fantastic drummer, too. So Michael makes it really easy. On that bus, I've got an EQ that looks like this, and I've got a compressor that looks like this. And let me play the mix so you can hear and see what's going on here and just get a sense of it all. Okay, so there's not a lot of compression going on. The ratio is just under 2:1. It's a soft knee. Attack is 1.7 milliseconds. Release is just over 1,400 milliseconds. And our threshold's pretty, it's at minus 7 dB, and I've got a makeup gain of 2.1 dB. So you can see what I've got there on the EQ. So what happens is, let me play you the mix. If I put that in and I keep these other things turned off, you'll notice the drums kind of collapse a little bit, and they don't collapse, but they just kind of, they get ducked down too much. Okay, now that's not bad, but it's not crossing the finish line to me. So what I do is, you'll notice on my drums, let's go here to the kick drum, for example. If we go to the bus, I'm just sending out to drums one. And drums one is what this bus has on it. But I also have this other drum bus that has the same input, but it's got a different compressor on it. And that compressor is got a much more radical setting on it. So let's solo the drums and just listen to that. Now you might say, wow, that's really compressed. And on its own, it really is, after a while, quite fatiguing, not the best sound. But when mixed together with the other drum bus that maintains a lot of the natural character of the drums, we get this. We get all the natural character and fullness of the original drum bus, but we get the punch of the compressed drum bus. And so there's a very, we'll call it a conservative compressor over here on the one drum bus, and then the another drum bus that has a more hyper-compressed situation. Listen. Okay, that's the main part of it. I've added a little bit of something to this one as well, where I created a third drum bus. We'll call it a third, even though I called it D2. And this bus, I'm kind of doing a hyper-compressed thing, as well as, let's see, my EQ that I did earlier was not on there, so let me put that back. A little high pass there. All right, so on this drum bus, it's called Drums 2, and it's got kind of a semi aggressive compression scheme going on. But to that, I'm only sending via the pre-fader sends up top here. I'm sending the snare, I'm sending the rack and the floor, and I'm sending the room. And you'll notice I've got these little faders up here too. So that allows me to create almost like a separate mix that goes just to that, just to dedicate to that one bus. So I'm going to turn that off. I'm going to play the two primary buses, the natural one and the hyper-compressed one, and then I'll add in the other one so you can kind of hear how that takes it up a notch. One, two, one, two. Fairly subtle, but it's something that in the mix we can push up and automate to taste just how we like it. So let's listen now as we play the whole mix. And I'm just going to slowly bring in the different drum buses. Let's do that now. Okay, here we go. Okay, so that, in essence, is parallel compression as interpreted by myself. So I hope that was a nice little tip for you and that you can use that in no matter what type of music you have, you're producing or mixing or creating in your world. I hope that this parallel compression thing works for you. You can do it on drums. You can do it on vocals. You can do it on guitars, keyboards, whatever. Make it work for you, but I think this is a great tool just to really give an instrument such as drums that are an important foundation to a mix, give them a place of prominence and maintain their, in this case, the drums, maintain the organic part of it, but at the same time, introduce just a little extra punch, which I think is, that's pretty crucial. So I'm Matt Boudreau. Thanks for joining in. Bye-bye.